Hello viewers, I welcome you on the lecture series of corporate accounting. Under today's lecture we are taking unit 6, and under unit 6 we shall continue our discussion on cash flow statements. It's the second part of our discussion on cash flow statement, where we will learn in detail about various methods of preparation of cash flow statements, and we will take up the practical aspect to understand the concept more clearly and precisely. In our previous lecture we have put our light, or we have put emphasis on the meaning and significance of cash flow, what is comprising of investing activity, financing activity and the operating activities. In today's lecture we shall continue our discussion over the cash flow statements, and we will highlight the various factors which are necessary to prepare the cash flow statements, such as comparative balance sheets, profit and loss account and additional information. When we are with these three data, that is comparative balance sheets, one balance sheet of the current year for which we are preparing and its previous figures, so that we can do a comparison of the change in the working capitals. When we talk about comparative balance sheets, it means the balance sheet of single organization, say X Limited, but we will compare the balance sheet of previous year as well as the current year. That means data of 2 years or more years would be compared. Profit and loss account shows the profitability of any business organization. So where we are going to follow the indirect method or direct method, at both the cases profit and loss account is very important, so that we can ascertain the required information. And additional information in relation to any provision being made or any payment of dividend etc. would also be collected in the form of additional information furnished to us. So these are the basic needs for preparation of the, or the basic tools for preparation of cash flow statements. Now how do we proceed to calculate the cash flow statement? We will follow certain steps. Let us highlight on these steps first. Calculation of net increase or decrease in cash and cash equivalent account. What comprises of cash and cash equivalent account? We have already learned it. So here our first step is to ascertain the net increase or decrease in cash and cash equivalent. How it will be ascertained? We will learn it gradually. The difference between cash and cash equivalent for the period may be computed by comparing these accounts given in a comparative balance sheets. Calculation of net cash provided by operating activities. That means what's the amount of gross inflows out of the operating activities would be ascertained in our second step. So we will take into account the cash receipts and the cash payments which are due to the activities which are being carried out to run the business activities. That means operating activities would be considered first, and we shall evaluate the results in the form of net cash received from the operating activities. It is by the analysis of profit and loss account, comparative balance sheet and selected additional information. So when we compare all these data, that is comparative balance sheets, P&L account and additional information, after that only we would be able to get our cash flows from operating activities. A more clear idea of ascertaining cash flows from operating activities would come when we will solve a question based on it. For our reference, we can say that when we take into account the cash receipts from debtor and we subtract the cash payments to suppliers, we can get the net amount received, and after that we can subtract the income tax paid, which can be ascertained out of the additional information, and we can also take into account any net increase or decrease in the working capital by comparing and analyzing the P&L account and balance sheets. Now again, continuing the procedure of preparing cash flows, our next step would be calculation of net cash provided by investing and financing activity. That means the first step would be to ascertain the cash and cash equivalent by comparing the differences of the two comparative balance sheet. Then we have to ascertain the cash flows from operating activities. When we have moved to third step, what we have ascertained is net cash provided by investing as well as financing activities. What fall under investing and financial activities? We have learned them in detail in our previous lecture. We can have a reference of the same. Investing activities are those activities which results in an investment which gives benefit in the long term period. That means the benefit out of the investment would accrue in the longer period, such as acquisition of plant and machinery, sale of plant and machinery. Such activities would fall under investing activities. And financing activities are those activities which are associated with acquisition of any source of finance or application which is necessary so that the dividends are being paid when we have taken certain source of finance. In order to take the use of those sources, what we are paying, that means charges which are necessary to pay off to use the finance would also come under financing activities, such as interest paid on dividend. All other changes in the balance sheet items must be clearly analyzed, taking into account the additional information and effect on cash may be grouped under the investing and financing activities. And the fourth step, that is lastly, we shall prepare the cash flow statement in the prescribed format as has been suggested under accounting standard 3rd, which is being issued by Council of Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. The fifth one is aggregating the net cash flows from each activity. Here each activity refers to investing, financing and operating activity. Now aggregating means we are adding up the cash flows which we have got in the final statement or the final column of the amount from each set of activities and comparing them with the figure of net increase or decrease in cash and cash equivalent. That means in our step 1 we have calculated that what is the net increase or decrease in the cash and cash equivalent. Then aggregate of all these activities would be either equal to them. So this is a comparative data, that's why we are aggregating all these three figures from the operating, financing and investing activities, and its aggregation would be equal to net increase or net decrease in the cash and cash equivalent which we have computed in step 1. Then at last what we are going to do is that reporting of significant non-cash transactions separately. Non-cash transactions are those transactions which are being recorded in the form of either adjustment entry or book entry. That means no cash is being affected, cash position has remained the same. For example, we have acquired the business of any company, that means we have taken over the business and instead of paying cash we have taken up their liabilities to be paid off. So it's a book entry or the accounting entry which we have passed and there is no effect of cash onto it. So such transactions would also be reflected separately, which are not being included in the cash flow statements because they are not going to affect the cash positions. Now we are with the small exercise so that we can analyze the items which are falling under investing, financing and operating activities. Once we are able to apply our knowledge to ascertain which activities are falling under which group, we can move ahead and solve the question. First one is dividend payment. Dividend payment is a financing activity because it is associated with the use of the resource. That means source of finance is being used and what the company is paying for using those resources, the dividend to the shareholders, because they have provided us the finance or equity to carry on the business. Second one is income tax paid. Income tax paid is generally considered as an operating activity because the income tax is being paid on the net profit unless it is specifically mentioned that income tax is being paid on the investing activity or financing activity. So here we will classify the income tax paid as an operating activity. Sales of goods will always be an operating activity. Purchase of building is an investing activity because we are investing into the building which will give us or which will be resulting in the long term benefits to the company. It's a long term asset. Sale of old machinery, again it will be falling under investing activity. So here we are having an idea of what activities would be falling under which stream. So once we are very clear conceptually that what items would be classified under which category, we would be able to present our data correctly under cash flow statements. now students, we are going to discuss a very important topic in relation to preparation of cash flow statement. Earlier we have learned that how the statements are going to be presented. Now what method to be applied to present the cash flow statements would be analyzed. So there are two methods which are being suggested, and they are the direct method and indirect method. We can follow either of the methods for the preparation of the cash flow statement of any business entity. When we follow the direct method, it means that we are preparing our cash flows from operating activities using the cash receipts from debtors and payments to the suppliers and employees rather than going to the net profit. So the only change is in relation to the preparation of cash flows from operating activities. Both the methods have a different approach to find out cash from operating activities. So we will take up an illustration so that we can understand the direct method of preparation of the cash flow statements. Here the question says to us that prepare cash flow statement using direct method. We are having the income statement and reconciliation of earnings for the year ended 31st March 2008. That means we are having a P&L account to be analyzed so that we can prepare our cash flow statement using a direct method. The first information given is net sales and it amounts to 25,20,000. Second one is cost of sales has been reduced out of it, that is 19,80,000. Then we have subtracted the depreciation 60,000, salaries and wages 2,40,000, operating expenses 80,000 and provision for taxation 88,000. Together what we are subtracting is 24,48,000 out of 25,20,000. So the net operating profits are 72,000. Now we are discussing certain incomes in relation to the P&L account which is being given. The first one is a non-recurring income. It is on account of profit on sale of equipments which amounts to 12,000. We are having the profits of 72,000 in our previous slide, and this 12,000 would be added up. So here we are having the receipts of 84,000. Retained earnings, that is balance in the P&L account brought forward, is 1,51,000. Its aggregate is 2,35,800. Dividend declared and paid during the year is 72,000. So P&L account balance as on 31st March 2008 is 1,63,800. Now we are having a comparative balance sheet. That means the current year's data as well as previous year's data are being given to us. First one is land and building. That is in the year 2007 it is 48,000, and now it is showing us a increased figure, that is 96,000. So there must be certain acquisition of the building and there would have been a cash outflow. Buildings and equipments in the previous year, that is in 2007, it is 3,60,000, while in the 31st March 2008 it is 5,76,000. There is an upward increase in the building, that means we have acquired building, the cash would have gone out of the business. Cash position as on 31st March 2007 is 60,000, while on 31st March 2008 it is 72,000. While understanding the procedure to find out the net cash and cash equivalent, what we have done is that we had ascertained the differences in the cash, that is in the beginning of the year it is 60,000, while at the end of the year it is 72,000. So there is a net increase of 12,000, and same would be the figure of the aggregate of all the activities cash flow. So next point is debtors. Debtors position is given as 1,68,000 on 31st March 2007 and on the year end it is 1,86,000. Stock 2,64,000 and in the year end it is 96,000. Advances 7,800 as on 2007 and in 2008 they are 9,000. So the total of the balance sheet asset side is 9,07,800 for 2007 and 10,35,000 in 2008. Now we will analyze the liability side. First one is capital. It's 3,60,000 in 2007 and in 2008 it's 4,44,000. So again the capital has also increased over here. That means inflow is there in relation to financing activities. Surplus in the P&L account 1,51,800 and 1,63,800. sundry creditors from 2,40,000, it has gone down, that is 2,34,000. That means we have paid off the creditors, so it's showing a decrease. Outstanding expenses 24,000 and 48,000. Income tax payable 12,000 and 13,200. Accumulated depreciation on building and equipment is 1,20,000 and 1,32,000. And the total is 9,07,800 for 2007, and for 2008 it is 10,35,000. That is matching with the asset side. We are having additional information as cost of equipment sold was 72,000. So this information is necessary when we prepare the accounts in relation to all these items, so that we can ascertain the cash impact of any activity being carried out in relation to selling or purchase of the equipment. Now we are moving towards the solution. So first of all, we need to prepare the cash flow statement for the year ended 31st March 2008, and the first item would be to ascertain cash flow from operating activities. Since it's a direct method, so first of all we will ascertain cash receipts from customers or debtors. It is coming as 25,02,000. Let us analyze how we have arrived at this figure. So we are having a sales revenue which is given in the question as 25,20,000. That is when we were given the income statement, first figure was in relation to the sales revenue, it is 25,20,000. In the comparative balance sheets, we are having the figures of debtors both for the 2007 and 2008. So what we have done, that in the sales we have added the debtors in the beginning, which were given to us as 1,68,000. So we are getting a consolidated figure of 26,88,000 and subtracted that debtors at the end of rupees 1,86,000. So what we have got is cash receipts from customers, and it is 25,02,000. Alternatively, the student can also prepare a customers or debtors account with the opening balance, closing balance, and sales would be recorded on the debit side, and what we will get as the balancing figure would be by bank, that is cash receipt from customers. So this is the first item which needs to be recorded under cash flows from operating activity. Now the second item is cash paid to suppliers and employees. Here this figure is coming as 21,15,200. Now the next item which is to be recorded in the cash flows from operating activities is cash paid to suppliers and employees. To ascertain the figure of cash paid to suppliers and employees, first of all we have to carry out a calculation. Here we are giving the cost of goods sold, that is 19,80,000 in our income statement. So we need to add the operating expenses and salaries and wages onto it, that is 80,000 and 2,40,000. They are also being given in the statement. So we are getting 23 lakhs. Now we will add the creditors at the beginning, that is 2,40,000, stock at the end 96,000, advances at the end 9,000, and outstanding expenses at the beginning, that is 24,000, that is 3,69,000 would be added to 23 lakh. So we are getting the figure of 26,69,000, and under it now we will do the further calculations, that is we will subtract the creditors at the end for 2,34,000, stock at the beginning 2,64,000, advances at the beginning 7,800, and outstanding expenses at the end 48,000. So we will subtract 5,53,800 from 26,69,000. So what we are getting as a final figure is 21,15,200, that is cash paid to suppliers and employees. Alternatively, creditors accounts and the relevant accounts, that is outstanding expenses accounts, could be prepared so that we can ascertain the final amount of cash paid to suppliers and employees. Here we have taken up all the calculations or adjustments in the single format and adjusted the figure of the cost of goods sold so that we can ascertain the cash payments to suppliers and employees. So we have put that calculated figure in this format as cash paid to suppliers and employees 21,15,200. So cash generated from operations is 3,86,800, and we have subtracted income tax paid of 86,800. Now how this figure has come? We are having the income tax payables figures and income tax paid figures. So how this figure of 86,800 has come? Let us understand it. We are having the tax payable beginning. We have added back the provision of 88,000 and subtracted the tax payable at the end of 13,200. So tax payable or tax paid at the end would be 86,800. So we will get net cash flows from operating activities of 3 lakh. Now similarly, we will prepare the cash flows from investing activity, where purchase of land would be subtracted and purchase of building 2,88,000 would be recorded here. We are having the opening balances of building and equipment as 3,60,000. Then we have subtracted the cost of equipment sold, which is given in the help of additional information, 72,000. So the WDV is 2,88,000 and balance at the end is 5,76,000. So how it has increased? Because we have purchased certain equipments and building, and this figure is 2,88,000. Same is being recorded under investing activities. Sale of equipment figure is coming as 36,000. We are having accumulated depreciation of 1,20,000. We have added back the depreciation of current year of 60,000 and subtracted the accumulated depreciation at the end. So what we have got is the figure of sales of 48,000. Then cost price is 72,000. And accumulated depreciation is 48,000. So the balancing figure is WDV. We have added the profit on sale, which is given in the income statement. So we have got the sale price of the equipment, which is being reflected over here. So net cash flow from the investing activities is minus 3 lakh. Now the third activity is cash flows from financing activities. The first item is issue of share capital of 84,000. Since there is an inflow of share capital, the shares are issued, because when we have compared the balance sheet, we have got to know that there is an upward increase in share capital. So here inflow is being recorded as 84,000, being the difference of both the capitals as has been reflected in the balance sheet. Dividends paid are given in the form of the information in the P&L account. We have subtracted the dividends, so we have got the net cash from the financing activities, and it is 12,000. And this net cash from the financing activities, then from the investing activities and operating activities would be added up. We know that cash flows from the operating activities is 3 lakhs. Then previous slide, if we recall, it is cash flow from investing activities minus 3 lakh. So plus 3 lakhs and minus 3 lakhs is 0, while that of the inflow from financing activities is 12,000. Now this 12,000, that's the aggregate of all the activities, is equal to the net increase in cash and cash equivalent, which we have calculated at the time of analyzing the comparative balance sheet. The opening figure of the cash was 60,000, while the closing balance was 72,000, and their difference was 12,000. That is, increase of the cash and cash equivalent was 12,000, which were our step one for the calculation of the cash flows. And the aggregate, that's the final figure of all the activities, total cash flow is 12,000. Now we have added the cash and cash equivalents in the beginning, 60,000, and got the cash and cash equivalents at the end, that is 72,000. So this is the procedure by which the cash flow statements can be prepared. Now we are concluding up our lecture of today, where we have discussed in length the method of preparation of the cash flow statement, and we have taken up a practical example to evaluate and understand the methodology of preparation of cash flow statement. With this, we are ending up our lecture of today. Thank you.